River and sea, jungle and sky, water flows freely between the two halves of the world. We are creatures of the water, such are the words of Shaper Tuvasa. The dying ask for water because they know it contains life. And Kestia is the cultivator of fertile fields, crop growth, and irrigation. The harvest god's cornucopia contains the fruits of the fields, the forest, and beyond. One water, two interpretations. Such is the divergence between Kestia and Tuvasa. These two commanders inhabit the same colors and share many core cards, but create distinctly different decks for you to decide between. Tuvasa, who can create a hardcore combo strategy, and Kestia for amazing Voltron power-ups. Longtime viewers of this channel will know that we're no strangers to Enchantress here at Talarian Community College. In fact, I have two deck techs for different flavors of Selesnya Enchantress decks, a Sigarda Voltron deck, and a pure Enchantress deck based on Karametra. When the new Bant Enchantress precon deck came out, it caught my eye because it finally gave us thematic commanders for the archetype. While I still love the original Selesnya decks, today we're going to talk about an upgrade path for both decks, the cards they share in common, and the different paths they walk. Your choices for commander are Tuvasa the Sunlit, a legendary merfolk shaman for green, white, and a blue. Tuvasa the Sunlit gets +1/+1 for each enchantment you control. Whenever you cast your first enchantment spell each turn, draw a card. And Kestia the Cultivator, a legendary enchantment creature for one of any color, a green and a white and a blue. Kestia is a nymph with bestow, where for three of any color, a green, a white, and a blue, you can cast her for her bestow cost, enchanting a creature with +4/+4, and whenever an enchanted creature or an enchantment creature you control attacks, draw a card. As a bestowed enchantment, it becomes a creature again if it's not attached to a creature. Which of these two do you use as your commander? Before we talk about the differences in decks, let's focus on the core, that which is the same in both decks. The common core of both these decks is familiar to most as an Enchantress build. Verduran Enchantress, Argothian Enchantress, Mesa Enchantress, Eidolon of Blossoms, and Enchantress's Presence are the classics, but recently we've gotten Satyr Enchanter in M19, and of course Tuvasa the Sunlit herself from the pre-con. Even if you choose to run Kestia, you'll make Tuvasa one of the 99. All these do a variation on the same thing, draw you cards for playing enchantments. This is the glue that holds the deck together, keeping our hand full and drawing us into whatever we need. Once every enchantment draws you two or three cards, turns get out of hand quickly, and so do board states. If we decide to go on an Aura Voltron plan, we also have Core Spirit Dancer and SRAM Senior Edificer to draw us cards when we play our auras. Another common core to these decks is, of course, an enchantment ramp. While I won't fault anyone for throwing in Kodama's Reach or Cultivate, having most of our ramp in the form of land auras gives us maximum synergy with the rest of the deck. Fertile Ground, Wild Growth, Utopia Sprawl, Overgrowth, and Weirding Wood are what I tend to run. And there are a bunch more options at the 3 and 4 mana level. I like Exploration to help us get more lands out, and Miari's Wake straight up doubles our mana. Carpet of Flowers is also a powerful ramp spell, so long as you have a blue opponent to feed on. Finally, we need an interaction suite, which is something you'll need to tune to your meta. Whenever possible, having our answers in enchantment form lets us benefit from our various synergies. Grasp of Fate is the multiplayer O-ring, letting us exile something from everyone. Imprisoned in the Moon and Song of the Dryads both deal with problematic permanence, turning them into harmless lands. Seal of Cleansing and Seal of Primordium destroy our opponent's artifacts and enchantments. So that's our core, what the two decks share. Now let's look at the two different builds, beginning with Tuvasa. Tuvasa the Sunlit is not the Bant Merfolk commander I've been waiting for, as I still want a Bant Merfolk commander that has Merfolk synergy. But Tuvasa is still really interesting, as she offers an awesome synergy with enchantments. I'll take what I can get. We're going to be leaning hard on Tuvasa's second ability, which is a fixed version of the classic Enchantress effect. Being able to reliably get the enchantment card draw train rolling every game gives the deck a huge consistency boost. We're going to use our enchantresses to draw tons of cards and assemble some sweet enchantment combos. Tuvasa getting huge is a nice side benefit, and it will occasionally be a way to finish off a game that we've locked down. But let's look at these combos. Bant Enchantress lends itself to some really degenerate interactions with some really old cards. Unfortunately, a lot of these cards are expensive, but if you do have access, you can do some broken stuff. If you have any judges in your playgroup, one alternate win condition is making their heads explode from some of the rules interactions here. Opalescence plus Humility is a classic interaction that puts the magic rulebook to the test. Opalescence makes all your enchantments creatures, including itself, but Humility removes all abilities from creatures. So what happens? You might think that Opalescence makes itself a creature, which means that Humility applies to it, which means that it loses its ability and makes itself a creature in the first place, so it stops being a creature, but then it has the mana ability again, which means that it makes itself a creature, which means that Humility applies to it, which means that it loses its, and then their heads explode. In reality, magic has an order in which effects are applied that sorts all this out. The enchantments become creatures, then lose all abilities, but losing all abilities doesn't retroactively stop the abilities that have started to apply. So both enchantments end up vanilla creatures. Their power and toughness are set by whichever enchantment was played second. So the net effect of all of this is that if you play Humility, you lock down your opponent's creatures as ineffective 1/1s. And then if you follow up with an Opalescence, all of your enchantments become beefy creatures that can beat down for a win if you set it up right. Starfield of Nyx is a backup Opalescence that only affects your own enchantments and can also get your enchantments back every turn. Enchanted Evening makes all permanents enchantments, which breaks the game in several ways. With Opalescence in play, this makes all lands into 0/0 creatures that die immediately. This will not make you very popular, and blowing up lands without a clear game plan is the absolute worst. But if done judiciously, this can let you protect a dominating game position and win quickly. The cards Aura Thief, Cleansing Meditation, and Calming Verse all become one-sided Armageddon Wrath combos with some hoops to jump through. Calming Verse is the most reliable since Mana Burn isn't a thing anymore, but getting 7 cards in your graveyard for Threshold isn't too hard either. A Johnny's Chosen makes infinite cats when you make an enchantment with Enchanted Evening on the board. Since each cat is an enchantment, a Johnny's Chosen and triggers again to make a new cat, and since it's not a May, this is a loop that can actually lock up the game and force a draw. Make sure you have some way to break up the combo once you get a sufficiently large cat army, where no one's going to be too pleased with you. Parallax Wave is not a very good card on its own. It can exile a creature or two, but since you lose a fade counter each upkeep, it's a very temporary effect. If Parallax Wave is a creature itself, though, via Opalescence or Starfield of Nyx, things get weird. Parallax Wave can exile itself, and because the exile and return triggers are separate, you do a Banisher Priest style maneuver over and over again to exile any number of creatures permanently. Activate the exile ability targeting an opponent's Olivia Valdarin. Then before it resolves, have Parallax Wave exile itself. Let that trigger resolve and Parallax Wave goes into exile. It leaves the battlefield trigger, now goes off to return the exiled cards, but that's just Parallax Wave itself right now. And so Parallax Wave re-enters the battlefield with its fade counters restocked. Now, finally, the trigger to exile Olivia resolves and she goes into exile permanently. The next time Parallax Wave leads the battlefield, it's a different object, and Olivia is stuck in exile. You can repeat this to exile all opposing creatures, and whenever anyone plays a creature, you can deal with it as soon as you get priority. Finally, Sigil of the Empty Throne plus playing enchantments isn't a particularly fancy combo, but pumping out Sarah Angels will get the job done before too long. You'll notice that while these combo finishes are sweet, none of them end the game especially quickly. If we're going to need multiple turns to win, we need a way to slow our opponents down. We can build ourselves a pillow fort with Dueling Grounds, Ghostly Prison, Propaganda, and Sphere of Safety, as this all discourages attackers, while Solitary Confinement stops them all together so long as we've got a draw engine online to keep our hand full. Privileged Position and Sterling Grove protect our enchantments from targeted removal, while Karmic Justice lets us threaten opponents sense with Armageddon if they mess with our stuff. Since we're not running any artifacts, we can also hate on them freely with Stony Silence, Suppression Field, and Aura of Silence. To tie all this together, we need some backup forms of card advantage to keep this deck moving. Corsair of Kruphix, Mystic Remora, Sylvan Library, and Rhystic Study all draw us cards, while Hannah ships Navigator, Sun Titan, Replenish, and Wildest Dreams get cards back from the graveyard. We also want to run as many tutors as possible in order to either assemble a combo or the protection piece we need to survive. Enlightened Tutor, Idyllic Tutor, and Plea for Guidance find us our enchantments, but our enchantresses are important enough that we want to run tutors for them as well, with creature tutors like Elidomri's Call and Green Sun's Zenith. Wargate is perfect since it gets everything. Academy Rector is a powerful card that tutors any enchantment onto the battlefield when it dies. If you have one, it's worth running an Omniscience, which can often let you draw your whole deck and win on the spot. We don't have a ton of ways to sacrifice the Rector, but High Market is a land that does the job, and Crop Rotation can fetch it. And Crop Rotation can also fetch the most important land for this deck, Sarah's Sanctum, which makes a ton of mana once we get going. Tuvasa Enchantment Combo is a fun and challenging deck to play, with triggers going off all over the place and multiple lines to victory. But maybe that's not your style. Maybe you're the sort of Magic player who wants to ignore what your opponent is doing and slap auras onto Bogles. If so, have I got a deck for you. Kestia the Cultivator. Kestia lends herself to a particular playstyle that isn't especially popular in EDH. Play creatures, slap auras on them, and attack. The problem, of course, is that this strategy folds hard to board wipes, but Kestia gives us a new way forward. We're going to draw so many cards that we can just rebuild after any setback. The bestow mechanic on Kestia is an important part of the plan to be resilient to board wipes and spot removal, because bestow was designed to minimize the 2-for-1 downside inherent to auras. If Kestia is enchanting SRAM, for example, and SRAM dies or leaves the battlefield for any reason, Kestia doesn't just go to the graveyard like a normal aura. She just changes into a creature form. Even if SRAM gets removed in response to you attempting to bestow Kestia, she doesn't fizzle like normal aura spells. She just resolves as a creature. This means that while 6 mana to bestow Kestia is a lot, so long as no one destroys her as an enchantment, we'll get 2 uses out of her, and only the second board wipe will send her back to the command zone. It's worth noting that damage dealt by a creature enchanted with Kestia isn't commander damage, sadly, and bestow is an alternate cost, so you still have to pay the usual commander tax. There aren't many bestow creatures from Theros that are pushed to EDH standards, but Celestial Archon, Eidolon of Countless Battles, Ghostblade Eidolon, and Hypnotic Siren are the best of the bunch. This deck loves to enchant creatures since they don't have to be enchanted to draw cards off of Kestia. Theros block has some other solid enchantment creatures like Archetype of Imagination and Corsair of Kruphix, but the headliners, of course, are the gods. As a 3-color deck, we're not going to be able to count on having enough devotion to activate the gods, so we're going to stick to the ones with useful effects. Ifara, God of the Polis, Heliod, God of the Sun, Karametra, God of Harvests, and Thassa, God of the Sea, all serve a useful purpose as enchantments on the battlefield, and if we ever get them online, they become terrifying beaters that draw us cards. Note that the tokens produced by Heliod are enchantment creatures, so they work with Kestia as well. The other mechanic that helps us survive board wipes is Totem Armor, which is sort of like the opposite of bestow. When a creature enchanted by Hyena Umbra would be destroyed, you destroy the Umbra instead and keep the creature. We run Bear Umbra, Octopus Umbra, Snake Umbra, as well as Umbra Mystic to give Totem Armor power to everything. To round out our aura package, we have Ancestral Mask, Armadillo Cloak, Daybreak Coronet, Eldrazi Conscription, Ethereal Armor, Sage's Reverie, Shield of the Oversoul, Spirit Mantle, and Unflinching Courage. Now, I promised you Kestia Bogles, so here are some Bogles with all the fixins. Slippery Bogle, Glade Cover Scout, Silhana Ledgewalker, Invisible Stalker are the classics. And Sigarda, Host of Herons, is kind of like a big beefy Bogle. Hexproof is great to minimize the risk of getting blown out by spot removal, but in this deck we need lots of enchanted creatures attacking to keep the engine moving. Bruna, Light of Alabaster, lets us cheat in tons of auras from our hand and graveyard, which can be insane in the late game. Cold Eye Selkie can draw us tons of cards once we've beefed it up, and Edric, Spymaster of Trest, is a backup Kestria that incentivizes our opponents to attack each other. Hydra Omnivore works well with our aura plan, and makes it so that we only have to connect with one opponent to damage everyone. Now, Yavimaya Enchantress isn't the card draw sort of Enchantress, but she still gets huge. Shelley, Voice of Plenty, may not have hexproof herself, but she grants it to everything else. And Sun Titan can get back dead creatures and auras again and again. The rest of the deck is just ramp and answers to anything that might harm our enchanted army. We fold to mass exile and bounce, so keeping a counterspell up for that whenever possible is advised. Retether is a budget replenish that can get back all our auras for a big turn in the late game. Sigarda's Aid isn't as good here as it is an equipment deck, but getting to use our auras as combat tricks and threaten to mess up blocks has a lot of value. For planeswalkers, Temio Field Researcher has a lot of synergy, drawing us more cards and tapping down blockers, while Estrid the Masked, the headliner of the precon, serves a support role here, doling out totem armor masks left and right. There are a few aura-specific tutors, and they're much more accessible than the general enchantment ones. Heliod's Pilgrim, Open the Armory, and Three Dreams. Lists to both decks are available in this video's description, but no matter how you build it, Enchantress is a flexible and powerful archetype, one with a rich history, and adding blue to the mix really turns things up to 11. Whether you're comboing off with Tuvasa or beating down with Kestia, your playgroup needs to pay heed to the enchantment menace. I hope very much this video has been of some help to you. What commander deck would you like to see a tech on next? Let me know in the comments below. And this program was made possible thanks to a sponsorship from Card Kingdom, as well as the Patreon support of viewers such as you. So thank you.